our host for this specific demo is schoolism.com. So big thanks to Schoolism. That's my host for online teaching. I do online teaching, find a little time each week along with my animation schedule. And so these are the classes that I teach there, available to work with me directly, but these are also all available as a subscription. But let's get right to it. So yesterday, the talk that I gave here for Lightbox was getting to the heart of every painting. And I mention that because that's my theme for the entire weekend. As artists, that's what we've got to be good at. In my career and yours as well, we have to tackle so many different subjects. Any place, any time of day, any color, any lighting scenario, any story moment, every emotion you can think of, you've got to have the versatility to capture that, which means you have to be very selective in what you do. And for me, a big part of my training ground has been both digital and landscape painting to figure that out. And so this is our reference, and this is the scene that we're going to paint together here. And let me talk you through what my thinking is on this. So this is from a trip. I got to do a workshop in Tel Aviv, Israel, and then, of course, spent some time sightseeing. And just outside of Tel Aviv, the little coastal town of Jaffa, this is a spot we came across. Well, it demanded a painting, but we didn't have time to stop and paint on site at the time. So I swore, you know, someday I would do something with this spot. Well, today's the day. And so what was remarkable about it? Well, it's this beautiful old world style of building. And I loved the way that these beige bricks were a similar value to the darkness of the waves down at the bottom here where there's less reflection. And so right up against the two, there's the warm bricks, there's kind of the sea green gray ocean, and they were a similar value. And that was just a remarkable relationship. Of course, the tower. It's all about the tower and that green copper top on the tower. It's an obvious focal area. Not every painting has to have a focal area, but this one demands it. So I really want to showcase that. Now, it's obvious to everyone, this is a snapshot. The camera overexposed it because the camera wants to see into the shadows. And so the sky is overexposed. So I have this other reference for you, which shows the sky a little bit better, but of course, it underexposes the shadows so it can get the sky. That's how the algorithm is set up, you know, in our point and shoot cameras and phones. But between the two, we have enough information to really dive into this. So I'm not going to silhouette quite this strongly. I want this image to be less about the value contrast and be more about the color contrast, something that I've seen is underused. We have this tendency when we want contrast, we automatically jump to, hey, let's put a light against a dark. All of us do it, and there's nothing wrong with it. But we tend to underuse color hue, you know, maybe putting a red against a green. Well, look at that sky. We have plenty of warm that we can put against that green copper top. And so that's exactly what I want to do. I want to really get the feeling of the notes I took on site, of closer value relationships and further color contrasts. Okay, so we're going to do it right here. I want you to open a file and I want you to make it about, it doesn't have to be a big file, 2400 pixels in width by 1600 in length. 300 pixel resolution is just fine. That's something like a 5x8, roughly a 5x8 proportion relationship. There's nothing magical about the proportion here, except that I thought it would fit the scene well. So the scene is being cropped from the photo. I don't want to do what's in the photo. I want to do what serves the image the best. And that's why we bother to paint from photos. Well, the photo never captures the experience of being there. And I kind of like painting from bad photos, frankly, my friends. I like taking notes and doing sketches on location. Because if you shoot a perfect, beautiful photo, then it's kind of done. But there was so much there to get into. And so this proportion is going to suit the proportion that I think fits the subject. So I've cropped the image down a little bit and I've put it up in the corner of the screen. So even if you're joining us late, you didn't have a chance to download the images. Again, those are on my Twitter account, but no worries. It's right here. It's pretty small, but it's going to be right up in the corner the whole time. Okay, you guys are itching to get painting. So keep that file open and let's roll here. I want to put a warm background in the painting. So I want you to reach for just kind of a middle orange because that sky, the sky has a nice underlying warmth to it. We have a sunset here. So I'm just going to fill up the whole frame with this kind of a salmon orange. You can keep an eye on my color picker up here. And that's going to help that sunset color really come through. It's also going to help the warm local color of the stone brick buildings to keep the warmth coming through from that as well. So get that roughed in really quick. And then critical to almost every painting that you do is knowing where the eye level line is. In this case, it's way up at the top. This is very important. Not only is the eye level line important in every image, so you know how your perspective is laid out, but the ocean, the top of the ocean is right up against the top of that tower. And I said all along that that tower is going to be a great focal area. And so with it intersecting the horizon line, that's going to really reinforce it. It's going to become kind of an X marks the spot for our focal area. So get that in. And then I'm going to place, I put down a center line here, which is right about where the right-hand side of the tower is. So just find the center, put a line there, and that's going to be the right-hand side of the tower. And the tower is going to be about this wide. So go ahead and get that in. Just be sure these are on a separate layer, by the way. These lines are for finding our composition, and then they're going to go away. Okay, and then the circle I just put in the lower right-hand corner, that's going to be that big bush and foliage there. And then I'm going to start sketching in the shape of the building. And I keep these line drawings, I keep them very simple and very geometric. I'm just trying to find the big placement and the big relationships. If I do more than that, not only will it take too long, but I'll have a tendency to kind of get lost in it. This is about the simple statement. I showed that title card from yesterday's talk very intentionally about getting to the heart of every painting, because that's the key to most of the artwork we do. What is it about? You've got to decide right up front. Otherwise, it's so easy to go off into the weeds. You start rendering leaves. I love leaves. Nothing wrong with rendering them. But if the leaves become more important than the tower, and the tower is what it's all about, and it's not about leaves, we're in trouble. So we're getting some simple silhouettes here, and we're going to keep things. I'm kind of a painterly guy. But at the same time, I want to keep this very graphic. So I'm actually seeing that my drawing needs to be scooted over just a bit here. Go ahead and make any corrections because the building goes just above the horizon line and I don't want too much of a gap between the tower and the building. And by the way, I'm going to make the tower a little bit bigger than it is and appears to be in the photo reference. Part of that is a lensing effect. You know, the smaller lens on the camera, on the phone, has an effect on the proportions. But also, more important than that, psychologically, to be there at that place, at that time, that tower really loomed tall and really filled your vision in an emotional sense. Well, if you want something to be a certain emotion, you have to really reinforce that idea. So I'm going to make that tower bigger, wider, and more present than it appears to be in the photo. Okay, so the circle I'm putting in now, that palm tree, I'm not going to draw a whole bunch of fronds. I'm going to get lost in it, and they're not going to line up properly. Those fronds come out, and their outer edge forms a very circular shape. So if I draw that big oval first with the trunk attached to it, well, it's just a big lollipop. I can do that. I'm capable of doing a lollipop. I'm not capable of a whole bunch of individual crafted fronds that perfectly line up with each other. So simplest statement possible, and then we'll add to it from there. When in doubt, keep it simple and then add the complexities later. For me, that's been the big reveal for how to find some success at traditional landscape painting, digital landscape painting, and concept art, art of any kind. Okay, so I'm just thinking about the big silhouettes here. And you know, in the photo, that big tree that's right up against the column, well, I don't like it there. I'm going to scoot it over and have it line right up with the tower, because the two of them together are going to be very powerful. Separate, they kind of weaken each other. But if I put that right underneath the tower, it's going to be really gutsy, I'm feeling like. So go ahead and sketch that in and consider that idea for your painting as well. And these are the kinds of choices I like to make. You know, this moment, it's gone forever. That moment will never exist, but I'm going to be stuck with my painting. So I've got to do what's going to give the painting the presence and the emotion that the original moment deserves. If I'm just going to copy a photo, well, nothing wrong with that. That's good practice in rendering, but that's not ultimately art. It's just practice. Okay, so we're trying to make art here, trying to make something that's special and hoping for the best and planning for the best. Yeah, and someone pointed out, and I didn't mention it, hold down shift. If you want these perfectly straight lines, just hold down shift and go vertical and you'll get it. Hold down shift, go horizontal and you'll get it. And that'll give you nice clean lines. It's very helpful for doing architecture when you need straight architectural lines. Okay, so I'm just kind of shaping things up here. The tree down in the right-hand corner, in the reference, it's a little bit wispy, but I want to make it a little more full because it'll give my scene a stronger compositional balance. There's a lot of visual weight on the left-hand side of this image, the tree and the big building over there. So for that reason, that right-hand foliage, it's going to be a little heavier. So I'm just going to leave that big circle shape. Okay, so let's just keep going. I'm just kind of chiseling out, making sure my column shape, it's a little thicker at the bottom. But notice how I'm just thinking about big silhouettes, big shapes, big rhythms. If you start sketching out, you know, if you're doing really busy, scratchy shapes, well, if you want a busy, scratchy image, sometimes you do, but usually not. So this is the way for this image. Yeah, thank you for the Nick Fury reference, at least the original Nick Fury, right? I wish I had the Samuel L. Jackson coolness, but thank you. Most of you have heard my eye patch story. It's not cosplay. By the way, let's just start in the sky. I'm going to start with the warm up there, but thank you for mentioning that because a bunch of you guys checking in are wondering, you know, is this guy like doing cosplay at home in his studio? No, I have to wear it temporarily, medical procedure. If you want to know why, actually just go after this is over or anytime, right at the top of my YouTube channel in the top playlist. It's right there. I did a story about it in last year's Lightbox talk. Not that you want to hear my story, but the talk was about how to weather really tough experiences in your freelance career. And when I originally went through this situation, it kept me from being able to work for a few months and I had to deal with that and gave a talk on preparing for the hard time. So you guys might like that talk as well. But let's get into the sky now. We are ready. So I've got just one middle gray cool stroke there to really show where the horizon line is. That's the top of the ocean, the horizon line. The eye level line is the same thing as the horizon line. No matter where you are in the universe, if there's a horizon, it will be at your eye level. And so in this case, I was up high, so the ocean is up high. Very important. Now I'm going to put a bright yellow up in the sky. Let's keep going here. And I'm going to put in a green. Now don't panic. you know, a green is a legit thing that really happens in the sky. And I'm going to start fairly saturated, knowing that it's going to tone down as I go. What happens is you have a warm yellow light from the sun, and you have cool blue light from the sky. Those two things can mix in the sky, and you can actually get amazing greens that really happen. And I'm going to have really rich reds, I hope. I'm going to have really rich greens, I hope. And so I'm going to play those relationships in the sky. So I'm going to have this grad that goes from yellow into greens, into cyans, and then to blue grays in the sky, falling off. So let them graduate. Make sure you have a good pressure sensitivity and just kind of a soft brush and get that gradation up in the sky. And then after we get that, we're going to get the clouds and we're going to get the reds, the red rims on the clouds up in the sky. But I don't want too much contrast. Notice how I'm putting a darker tone in my top left corner. I'm doing that very intentionally because I don't want us to look up there. That wasn't really in the reference and at the scene, but I don't want us to be drawn up to that corner with a super high contrast. I want to bring us back to the middle where that tower and the green crest of the tower is going to be. So that's a little compositional tweak to get that. Okay, I'm starting to indicate there's just some clouds doing their thing, sweeping across the sky here. It's going to gradually get darker, closer to the ocean. We need that horizon, but that horizon also can't have too much contrast. I don't want the horizon to be this razor sharp, light against dark edge. It'll draw too much attention to itself. So as we go, I'm going to have everything graduate darker as it gets lower and to screen right. And so, Andrew, I am painting in Photoshop here, and there's all kinds of custom brushes that come with Photoshop, and they have a little texture on them, and you can go up, you know, in the brush palette, there's a texture setting. You can put a little, you just turn on texture and get a little bit. So experiment. There are so many different brush packs out there. I don't have a brush pack that I put out. The reason for that is so many of my brushes have been given to me by other artists or we developed them at the studios. And so I don't feel like I can, you know, give those away since I didn't develop them myself. So I don't have a brush pack, but scout around and definitely can get there. What I'm using, I don't know if it's called the same thing anymore or if it's available in the latest download of Photoshop, but it was just a standard. This is a standard Photoshop brush that came with Photoshop. It was either called Chalk Number One or Pastel Number One. And it has a tiny bit of texture added onto it in the brush palette. And that's it, with pressure sensitivity on it. Nothing fancy, but it does give, you know, a little bit of an organic and a soft stroke. Okay, now a little bit darker than the sky. And notice how that warm underpainting is giving us a little bit extra color. So I don't have just a dead gray. There's a little bit of, I like to call it marbling. Instead of having dead passages of color, there's a little bit of variety built in the color. Now, this isn't a formula. I don't think you should always throw down a warm wash. I do it a lot. A lot of landscape painters do it a lot. But I try and force myself either to avoid doing it at all or start with a cool or a green or a purple to make sure that I don't have a single formula that I use all the time. Formulas are bad because we tackle so many different locations and so many different subjects with different moods and emotions. What a shame to approach all of the variety in exactly the same way. Okay, so avoid formulas, avoid approaching everything you do in the same way. But for this case, I think it's a good starting point. I'm getting darker and grayer as I go down now. So just, you know, I'm just keeping the color picker. I'll go down, you know, cyan, and then go a little more blue and a little darker and just click a little bluer and a little darker until I'm a little more neutral until I'm down into this range. And this is pretty much like a 50% with a little bit of cool in it that I'm getting now here. And you should be seeing my color picker. Oh, I see. My picture is right in front of it. That's tricky. I wonder if I can... I don't know that I'm able to move that. Yeah, sorry about that, guys. That comes built into it. And I have this, I have the placement baked into the video. So in this particular case, it is what it is. So let's drop in that column now. We want to make it just a little bit darker than the ocean and warmer in the building as well. So this is just, it's just a warm gray, about kind of a 60, 65% value. So it's going to be darker than most of the ocean, but about the same value as the lowest, darkest portion of the ocean water back there. And we're just going to fill all of this area in with this darker value. And I'm going to go to... I'm looking at moving this a bit so that you guys can see the color picker, but I don't know that it's going to be possible. Yeah, apologies about that. That's how I'm, the way that we're able to do this, because YouTube doesn't have a screencast function. And so I have to do it through Zoom. And so Zoom decides for me the setup here. But we've got it all filled in. So let's put a little bit of a grad in there. Let's get a little bit of purple down below here. So I want to just shift slightly. And just make that brown a little bit more purple over here to the left. And so, yeah, Frozen Flights has a good question about when my reference is obviously somewhat different than what I'm picking here. So part of it was the experience of being there, but I specifically know ahead of time that I want less value contrast and more color contrast. So I have light values at the top of the sky, but I'm intentionally getting those grads, those value grads. And then I'm just thinking about temperature. The ocean is a cooler gray. The landscape, the building is a warmer gray. And then we just take it from there. And then once I have the values and temperatures worked out, I think about the levels of saturation, how much saturation of color. And right now it's pretty muted, except for the sky. The primary saturation is going to be in the sky and the kind of cyan copper top of that column. So notice, because I want to just take a a step back here. There's something really important I want you to consider. The landscape, the buildings get browner and darker as they go down and I'm getting them in there. Notice how I kept the greens the same value over here on the side. I want this to be very graphic, very grouped, like I keep saying, so that it's more of a color statement. Now I am going to get some very dark foliage in there, but the contrasts are going to come last. Now that's not a formula. That's not the proper way to paint, but I do think it's a useful way to approach this image. So we're keeping everything as we change color hue, green, brown, purple, we're keeping very neutral and we're keeping very similar in value. So let's pick a middle cyan here. Something that's a little darker than the sky and has some saturation. And this is going to be the shadow color for the top. And this is our key. This is very important here. We can tweak it later if we need to. But there's a lot of skylight coming down. So the top light is going to be cooler and lighter. And then the side plane there of the dome is going to be darker. And it's going to have more of a cyan touch in it. Okay, and then let's just put the little cap on there. And Robert, thanks for checking in. Robert's asking about how we decide some of my paintings are kind of loose and quick, and some of them are more involved. And when do I decide to go more detailed? And frankly, it depends on the client or what it's for. In animation, we do key shots, or we might call them a movie moment painting, that really needs to tell the whole story of that moment. And those are pretty worked out. But a lot of the work are kind of quick VisDev or visual development pieces, or quick color keys that are meant to establish the tone, the mood, the story, but not meant to have a lot of time spent on them. And then at a personal level, I don't like to spend a long, long time rendering. I'm kind of a get in and get out kind of a painter. And so I tend to not do highly detailed, polished work. I like to get the impression of it, get good contrast and a good crisp finish in the important parts, but let the rest be secondary. Okay, so it does get quite a bit darker down at the bottom. If you look at the building, there's a darker local color down below. The building has darker, warm stone at the bottom. Well, that's really nice because I keep saying that we want to bring our focus up to that building. And so having that darkness, that gradation at the bottom is very helpful. At the same time, there's a little bit of foreground peeking through. You notice in the photo reference, there's some lighter stones at the bottom. I'm leaving those in because it establishes a foreground layer. That gives us a little bit of depth. There are so many competing elements in a landscape or in any kind of an environment, and it's hard to juggle all of them, but depth is usually very important. And so getting a sense of foreground, midground, and background can help with depth. Not every image has to have those things, but it helps. And then having good perspective helps with the depth. And we are going to be indicating more perspective coming up. Right now, I'm just thinking about the graphic read first. Okay, so this is the speed I paint at. Here, someone was checking in, and I believe this goes for a little over an hour. And so you'll see, you know, kind of pausing and humming and hawing and, you know, what should I do next as it's happening. But what I did do is grab a texture brush. So this is nothing fancy. This is just another, it's like the same brush with a heavier Photoshop texture, a heavier texture turned on to it. And you can just go into the brush settings and you can go to like a hard mix of settings and get a stronger, heavier texture. So you don't have to have some magical brush pack, but we do need to now suggest some breakup in that foliage and get some local color in there. So it's darker than the underpainting. It's a good green, but it's not a highly saturated green. It's kind of a neutral green that we're laying over there. I do recommend doing this on a separate layer so that you can tweak it if you need to. And we have more light hitting the top of the foliage, and we have darker underneath the foliage. And so I'm getting those gradations in now. It also really helps, though, those dark browns we got at the bottom of the painting, those help because those are about the same value as the darker foliage. And so you get a real rich marbling of warm and cool or red and green down under. The main part of the foliage is usually the outer part. The leaves are reaching out for sunlight. And so deeper underneath and within any tree or plant, you know, leaves don't want to grow in there. It isn't useful. And so you have the brown twigs, you have the brown branches. And so we've set up what really happens. And so it gives us kind of an impressionistic stroke that also has some realism in it. So I'm doing the same thing here, letting it gradate down to something darker and a little bit warmer, coming down into the browns underneath. But remember my thing about that middle tree coming up right underneath that tower? You see how that reinforces the tower? It gives it a little bit more authority. That's how we've got to think. I think a lot about composition. I teach a class on composition. I fight, you know, and suffer for composition, trying to figure things out that'll help strengthen the purpose of an image. Because to me, the definition of composition is taking all of the stuff that our images are filled with and getting them all to work together in a meaningful way. That's really hard to do. It's a major area of study, but it has to happen. If we're going to do images that have great purpose, and if we're going to get down to the heart of each image we do, then we've got to get all the different pieces and parts to plug in together, to fit together meaningfully. So that's what I'm trying to do here. That's why I'm enhancing, I'm giving greater girth to the tree in the lower right, to balance against the girth, the visual weight on the left-hand side, and why I'm reinforcing the tower with the tree in the middle. So keep just kind of hammering away, just get some kind of loose shapes. Don't worry too much about the palm fronds yet. I have a little technique for it that I'll use here in a moment, but I'm just getting the simple shapes and simple masses still. And there's a couple questions about the layers. Whenever something is unique, I usually put it on a separate layer so that if I need to manipulate it, it's not baked into the layers underneath. Sometimes when I'm just doing a quick, fast study, you know, I just need to get in and get out, I use no layers at all because I'm not trying to impress anyone. I'm just warming up or practicing. But in this case, hey, I knew you guys were going to be watching and I do need the selectivity of it. And so that was a consideration. But at the top of the foliage, there is some skylight. There's a big open sky up above us here. If we could look straight up, if you were there with me and looking straight up, the sky is pretty blue, despite all of the clouds down at the horizon near the sunset. Straight up, we have a deep azure sky. And so there's a lot of blue light coming down from above. So you notice my foliage is a little cooler at the top, but not on the sides, because the top catches some of that skylight. So it's not a huge value change. It's not a sparkly rim light. It's just a suggestion, but it gives some believability to your work. And so consider that. Okay, so that texture brush that I just had, I'm just flattening it down. So it's a flat line you see here, just going into my brush settings. And so I'm also putting direction. So I'm putting initial direction on my angle jitter here. That's under shape dynamics here in the brush palette. Okay, so angle jitter, initial direction. And then I'm using that, I can curve my brush around and I can suggest some palm fronds, just a simple little technique. Again, it's nothing fancy. And the palm fronds typically grow out from a center. There's two areas they grow out from there. And I'm trying to conform them to that round shape. You'll notice that if you go to the outer edges, the upper dome of the palm tree there on the left, if you just drew a circle around it in the reference, it's quite round. We have a tendency to not notice that and to get those palm fronds growing all over the place, but they don't. You know, this is a tree. It grows out from a center in a fairly even structured fashion. And I want you, when you do your landscape painting, always look for structure. It gives more purpose, more believability. We have this hard baked in tendency in our head. We notice contrast. That's where the information is. It makes sense. You know, our brain always wants to get the most information out of what we see. Of course, we notice contrast. But then we have a tendency to notice contrast and then paint that, and we don't notice what unifies what we're seeing. It's often more important to notice and to paint what unifies the image and then design the contrast. I hope that makes sense. Contrast is what your audience is going to look at. Design the contrast. Design the unity. Those two things together are going to give you that purposeful, meaningful painting. Okay, so I hope your foliage is shaping up, but you'll notice mine's pretty rough. You know, it's just kind of slapped on there. It's just suggesting a little bit of a quality of a palm tree, or at least there's frond shapes growing out there. No big deal. Keep it grouped. Keep them a little darker than your building. The value of the building is important. The darker value of the trees is important. Yeah, and Matt mentioned about the value of doing grayscale studies. Absolutely. If your color, if you're painting digitally and you're struggling with your color, my first recommendation, all the way down at the level of, you know, you call tech support for your computer and they say, okay, click the off button and restart your computer. You know, down at that level, if you're struggling with color, turn your images to grayscale, because value is often the most important component of color. If your values read, you can make some pretty big color mistakes and your image will at least still look competent. So grayscale is at the core of most good images. Now, I mentioned that we're reducing grayscale here, but it's still important. So you'll notice I'm getting some windows into the building there. Notice I also laid down some perspective lines. So there's a perspective in the scene. And I want to point out, we're seeing a little bit of a side view of that left-hand building, and it's pointing inward. That's really amazing that it's set up that way. We're looking at a corner of two buildings coming together, and where this complex meets, as if there's a courtyard down below us in the middle, and then the corner of buildings to the right and left meet, and the column tower comes up from there. That's really helpful because the perspective points straight out to the column. I keep calling the tower a column. We'll go with it. And so both sides, the perspective points right up into the tower. And so make sure you get that tipped perspective there. Notice how my lower windows have a perspective that lets us know we're looking down at them. Windows also give a scale. So whenever you're struggling with scale in your image, even if you have to cheat some windows or cheat the scale of your windows, people know roughly how big a window is. There's kind of a standard human size. Even if, like, it's kind of the thing for sci-fi artists, you have a spaceship out in space, nobody knows how big the spaceship is. There's no frame of reference. If it's important to give it scale, then put windows on your spaceship. If you want a giant spaceship, put little teeny tiny windows in it. And then everyone looks at it like, oh, wow, it's a giant spaceship. How do they know? The only way they know is the windows. Okay, they reflect the sky. And so I'm putting some cool reflections in the windows. Just a little here and there. You can see it in the reference. They're reflecting that sky. And so that's going to give the glassy finish. Yeah, someone asked if there was anything inspired me when I was young. The first artist that I came across, like I was like 15 years old in an art magazine, a painter named Richard Schmid, S-C-H-M-I-D, just masterful landscape and portrait painter. And his drawing was just technically exquisite. But the paintings and drawings had such an extraordinary kind of quality of lost and found. The image, even though they were technically precise, they didn't look photographic in the fact that he tried to hit you over the head, impressing you with rendering everything. He would render what was beautiful to him, and he would just let the rest just kind of disappear into each other. It was amazing. It was like a revelation to me. And so that was my first big inspiration. So as you're working on the tower here, notice how my dark band I just put around it, it wraps around. We're looking down into it. And so as we look further and further down into the architecture, it's going to be a rounder and rounder shape. So the very top of the tower is flat at the horizon. But then that little band of blue things, their little blue lights around there, they go around it in a little bit of a curve. And then down below here, there's this kind of guardrail. I'm putting a little bit of strokes at the top, but this little guardrail is a little bit rounder again, because it is a cylinder and you've got to get that cylindrical shape in there. Now, this is an old building. You know, it's not ancient. Jaffa is mentioned back to the Bronze Age, the history of this place. Extremely old and important port town, to my understanding anyway. This building is not that old, but it does have some weathering. So I'm just putting some streaks, you know, some streaks showing the age and kind of dripping down from those windows. There's a top plane. I just put a lighter top plane middle right, that lighter value, because there's a top wall there that's catching a little bit of cool light. That's important. We're looking down into that wall. But see how this is shaping up? Hey, this is that hasn't been too painful, right? We're getting a rich value and color combination here. So let's get out into the ocean and render a few waves. So I want to point out, I'm going on about perspective because of how critical perspective is. So at the horizon, it's got to be completely flat, and my brushstrokes stay very flat. But just like the tower here, the tower gets rounder and rounder and rounder. If we could see down to the bottom of the column and had lines wrapping around them, they'd be very round. Well, notice that my brushstrokes are getting and will get more open at the bottom, flatter, flatter, more open, more open, more open. And that gives a sense of perspective, and the waves do that. So I've got to make sure, and that's how you can get quick gestural brush strokes that not only have a little bit of energy to them, but they also describe the form that they're falling across. Make sure those brush strokes describe planes and describe perspective. And that's it. You know, I'm going to put a few light strokes out here for the ocean. There's a little bit of white water there. But for my overall strokes in the ocean, that's it. That's all I need. So that value gradation and the flatter to more open brush strokes describes it for me. Yeah, and asking about the shape of the waves, I'm not worried about that. For this image, because I don't want this to be too much about getting busy waves in. It could be someone else might be much more interested in the waves and focus on that. But the only thing that we need, I think, here is the top plane of the waves. You know, a wave has, think of the curl of the wave. Some of you wish you were out surfing one this weekend. But the top of the wave has the white water, and it also catches the light. And then the front plane of the wave is darker. And you notice that's exactly what I'm doing, putting that white stroke at the top of the darker area. And then I just let it kind of zigzag down, and it's done. Okay, so let's come back and just do a little bit of pushing and pulling in the building. I need to kind of correct my perspective in the windows a little bit. So let me clean that up. Okay, and so I'm going to do a little bit more up here in the sky. But Matt is asking an excellent question. So you could just keep an eye. I'm just going to get a little bit more visual activity up here to suggest a little bit of light hitting clouds. Same as the waves. I put down a dark shape and it's representing a thing, a shadow. But the side facing the light is catching the light. So just like the waves have a top plane catching a little bit of skylight. Then they have a front plane that's darker. And we can just indicate that doing the same exact thing. Notice that I'm keeping the contrast near the tower. I'm intentionally not doing a lot of contrast way in the outer edges of the sky. And that's a compositional choice. So Matt mentioned, you know, we kind of hear the thing about, hey, tangents are a problem and they can be a faux pas, having two different things coming right up against each other, which can be absolutely true. But sometimes new artists get the wrong idea. They kind of hear from maybe their favorite artist or teacher, hey, you know, watch out for tangents, it creates problems. They often do, but why? You always, if your favorite artist says something, do not do it unless you know why it works. Why is a tangent a bad thing? Well, because it creates an awkward tension and because it draws a lot of attention to itself. Two things come right up against each other and they automatically draw a lot of attention to itself. Well, guess what? That's exactly what we want in that tower. We want the eye to go right to it. We want a tangent. So no, tangents are not automatically bad things. And it's kind of terrible that there's kind of gotten this idea out there, hey, tangents are bad. They're not all the time. I use tangents intentionally all the time, just like I have here, because I want the top of that tower to really be an X marks the spot. Hey, look at this. This is the main event. Now, if I had a big X marks the spot somewhere else, a tangent somewhere else, that would be really bad. And it would, because it's a distraction. So it's not tangents, it's distractions are bad. Everything I'm doing here, I'm trying really hard to design, where the contrast is and where the contrast isn't. So that was a great question, Matt. Appreciate you bringing that up. So notice then, if you're struggling at all with this sky, it's just the gradation, yellow to a kind of a gray orange, to a gray, to a cool gray, to a blue gray, gradually getting darker. That's all it is, a grad going through that range. And then take your darker areas and get a little light hitting spots. And let that light, you know, make it feel like a form. It's a cloud and there's a little warm rim light hitting the cloud. And that's it. It's a little harder, you know, the side facing the light is a little harder edged. And then the side wrapping away from the light's a little softer. But let's come into this. Let's just clean up and get a slightly more saturated color into our main event here. So see how I'm getting, this is as saturated as that color will go in the shadow, but I can get it a little bit more saturated into the lighter area. Okay, that seems about right. So I'm gonna just, and notice that's nearly the same value. That lighter kind of cyan green stroke is not much darker than the background because I don't want a value pop there. I want a hue pop. Orange, kind of red orange against a green cyan. That's what I want to be special. Okay, and there's kind of this cool shape up there, the top, that kind of weather vane shape up there. I want to get that. That's a nice original accent. Okay, down here, there's a little bit, it's almost like there's kind of a patio area down there, but all I really want to show is that's the top of a wall, and there's some openings down there, some equipment, you know, solar panels down in there. I'm not going to render that, but that shows us the perspective. So this top of the wall here, it's valuable because it shows us a perspective, which gives us form. It lets us know where we are and where we're standing, and it points right into the tower. A little bit of a wall, we can see a tiny bit of the top plane on the other wall, just right to the left of the tower. So I have a tiny bit of a top plane there. But this is coming along. This hasn't been so painful, right? Simple statement, simple relationships. We have a plan right up front and we're executing that plan. Okay, so I'm just doing a little pushing and pulling here then, just kind of anything that has a little too much contrast, I'm knocking it back. Anything that doesn't have enough contrast, I'm adding to it. So for instance, the horizon line over to the right, I kind of group that with the sky because I don't want us to look over there. And then I'm coming in and the top of my foliage, I'm slightly lightening. I'm just using like the burn and dodge tool there and erasing out a little bit so that the top area of the foliage is a little lighter and the lower areas get a little darker so they have form. Because if you think about, if you just imagined again, a dome surrounding the foliage, that's how we can think about it. It has that three-dimensional form. It has a top, it has a side, it has a front. The foliage does. Okay, I'm going to pull a little trick here. Forgive me. You know, I always feel like I have to give a speech anytime where I use a tricky adjustment layer, but the grouping is very important to me here. So I'm going in the artist palette. If you just go to the, palettes, and you just pick accented edges, I want to do this to give a little bit of an extra punch to the shapes. But let me be very clear. I'm going to erase most of it back out. A lot of us struggle with, we do a painting, but the painting looks kind of false and digital. Do you guys have that experience? You know, you do a series of layers and adjustment layers over top. You do color modes over top to kind of push and pull and make adjustments. And in some ways they help, but at the end it has this false digital feel. Well, often the reason that happens is when you put a layer over top of your entire painting, that layer treats the entire painting the same way. Foreground, midground, background, light, shadow, front plane, side plane, you know, top plane. That layer treats all of those different things exactly the same way. Real life does not work like that. So when you adjust, do adjustment layers over top, you've got to decide what layers or what parts of your image it should affect and what parts it should not affect. Otherwise, you'll get that false, fake feeling. And a pro will spot it every time. You know, you're showing your portfolio, a good art director will say, nah, you've got that false. You have some nice stuff in there, but everything you're doing has a little bit of falseness to it. And that's often the reason why. So I am doing this. I'm having fun with it. Hey, the tools are there to be used, but selectively. Okay, so just play with those settings and you could do it later, but see what it did to my image here. And let's just go ahead and run that filter then. Okay, so you can see what it did to the image. It blurred out the details and it accented the edges of the shape. I'm going to bring back most of what I had, but I just want to leave a little bit of that graphic quality. I really like being painterly, but the painterly strokes can take away from, they can end up overpowering the image. No one thing, you know, any one idea can defeat all your other good ideas. So for me, often I love brushwork so much that it'll ruin the whole painting. So this is an attempt to group. Okay, so let me take that and I'm going to put... Oh, and by the way, I did copy the whole image. So I put a flattened layer of the entire image. That's how I got this filter. I put the filter over top of entire layer. Now I'm going to push and pull and work with it. And Artistic Strawberry, yes, this will go up on my YouTube channel. So this will be here for you. Okay, I'm actually, I'm adding a sharp, this wasn't crazy enough, I'm actually putting just a regular sharpening filter over top of it. So the stuff I'm doing is just in the filter galleries. And so I actually sharpened it a little bit so that when I reduce, I'm taking the transparency of it now way down. So there's just a hint of it, showing what was underneath, showing the original painting. I took the transparency way down to about like 25%. And now I'm gonna just erase parts out of it, leave bits of it, and see what we can get. And the filter was Accent Edges. So if you just go to the filter gallery, it's just up here, and then click on filter, you know, and the palette's up here, and then filter gallery, and then the filter is Accented Edges. Go crazy with that filter, have fun with it, but I guarantee it will ruin some stuff. And so you'll have learned what the limit is, you know, what's going too far, and pull back from it. Okay, so I'm throwing down a curves layer now. I like using curves layers to tweak values because curves, you can just pick very narrow ranges of value. And I made a big fuss about how I want the building to have a similar value to the ocean because I want the cool ocean and the warm building to really play temperatures. And so I'm going in and I'm darkening, and carefully, you can see I'm pulling down the middle area of the, I put a series of points, and then I'm just pulling down the middle dark values. And it's only that ocean and the similar values coming down to match my building. And that's giving me that graphic. So look at how that's pulling our attention back up to the top of the tower. By grouping all of that in value, we're doing what we said we would do at the top of the demo. We're bringing attention. We're moving heaven and earth to force you. You know, the tangent, someone was worried about the tangent. I'm sure you might be panicking about the filter that I just used. You know, I think it's worth panicking about. But we are just moving heaven and earth to say, hey, the top of that tower is the end point. I want to point one other thing out, though, as we go. This has a very hard defined focal area because this place, I felt, demanded it. Not every painting you do has to have a focal area. Paintings can be about lots of different things. There can be one thing on one side, another thing on another side, and an interesting connection between the two. So once again, there's no formula that says you must always do a focal area. In fact, if you always do a focal area, I think you have a crutch that you overuse. I have to be careful not to overuse always throwing everything at one focal area. It's just one good idea of many that serves this particular image. Okay, so let's keep tweaking our values there. But I think that helped. See how that really helped our attention. And so I'm just going to kind of pull back and forth and compare that, kind of turn it on and off and compare it to before, make sure it's giving me what I want. But I do have, I feel, that graphic read that I was looking for. Graphic partially in value, but especially in hue. Everything we see, value, color hue, and color saturation. There is nothing else. Everything you see every moment of your life is those three things. So that's what I'm thinking about. What value, what color hue, and what level of saturation or desaturation. Okay, so now I'm coming in and I put up a levels layer here just to group a little bit more, but I'm erasing part of it back out. Back to that idea, I can't treat everything in the image the same way. And so my levels layer let the lower areas be, the corners be a little bit more grouped. Now I want to come in and put a little bit more contrast back into my foliage. The foliage does, you know, it has a presence, it has some contrast, it has leaves. And we've been fighting so hard to keep everything grouped that now we need to pull out a little bit and give a nice texture. So I'm just working around the edges and adding a little bit more of a varied edge. And if you checked in, you know, late or recently, nothing fancy. This is just a brush. You know, you just go into Photoshop textures and you can set your texture on something really heavy, like hard mix is one of your texture settings in the brush palettes. And just there's so many textures that come built into Photoshop. Pick a gravelly texture and experiment with it. And there it is. But don't overdo it. Don't scream at us to look too far away from the main event. I'm just looking over at the comments while we go here and just kind of push and pull a little bit at the image. But the nice thing now is we can really feel what the image is. And it's just a matter of fine tuning. And I do want to put a little bit of value contrast at the top of the building. There is some value contrast in this image, but with a very careful control. Yeah, and I appreciate you guys have some really nice comments going about digital painting and traditional painting and the challenges. If you can do a little practice sketch, 20 minutes every single day, just do a little practice sketch, look at some reference, look at an artist you admire, or just doodle. You'll get more and more comfortable with it. You want to get it like muscle memory. You know, like if you ever learn to drive a stick shift car, at first it's a disaster. You know, like I got to steer and do my, you know, do the stick shift and the pedals all at the same time. But after a couple of months, it just becomes muscle memory and you can do it without even thinking about it. That's where you've got to get. You've got to get your tools at a muscle memory level. If you do that daily practice, that'll happen. If you don't, it never will. So here's something I almost always do. I flip my images. Because after I've been staring at them for an entire hour, as we have here, I get a little bit numb to what I'm seeing. I even do this when I traditionally draw on paint. I actually carry a mirror around with me. And like people look at me funny, like I might be in a life drawing class, and I'll hold a mirror up to like I'm in a, you know, prison mirror or something. I'll hold a mirror up and look at the model in a mirror. And the model always looks at me funny. And then at the break says, what does the mirror do? Well, by seeing the image flipped, it lets me get a fresh look at it and I can see my mistakes. And I always see mistakes that I didn't see. So for instance, right now I can see there's too much contrast, like the upper building that's now on the right, screen right, there's too much contrast up there. And I didn't even notice that as I was painting along. I thought I was grouping things really nicely and really bringing us up to the tower, but I'm not. I've got a problem up here that I've got to solve. So it's a matter again of designing the contrast. So let's play around with that a little bit and make that correction. And by the way, I threw a border around it. Just, you know, you can go to, you just go to, you select the whole canvas, you go to selection, and there's a choice in there to make border. Of a few pixels, and then I just fill that. I like to put a little border around the images so I can see it cleanly against my background. Okay, so I have my adjustment layers where I've made things lighter and darker. I'm putting them together in a group so I can just kind of turn them on and off and see if they're working together. But I've got a group that bad area, I've got to group that more. So I'm painting out the group. I put a layer mask onto the group and painted out some of the areas that have too high of a contrast. And then I've made a flattened layer on top of everything. So we have a fresh layer now. And I'm just going to ignore everything underneath. It's as if it doesn't exist. And I'm going to use the burn tool, the darken tool. I'm going to darken highlights. And I'm going to use that to darken some of the values further away and down from the tower. So where the foliage, you know, there's less light present in the lower areas of the building and the outskirts of the ocean. So I'm darkening those areas and giving them less contrast. And that's why I like to flatten the whole thing. I could just use the darken tool, the lighten tool. Don't overdo it. The burn and dodge tools, if you use them too heavily, they have an artifacting effect, meaning they'll kind of burn out. They'll change the color as they change the value. And then you start to get that false digital effect because the computer's deciding what color instead of you when you burn and dodge too hard. So I usually use them to lighten or darken maybe by 10 or 15%. If you lighten or darken more than that, then your colors start to change drastically in a way that you didn't intend. Okay, so I'm just kind of glazing over. I'm just painting right onto this. I'm in color mode. I clicked on color mode and I clicked screen for the brush mode. Screen lightens shadows towards whatever color you pick. And so if you have a darker area, you want to make it more green and lighter, well, just pick screen it for your color mode and then push your color picker over into green and then just lighten an area towards that. I also want to push some browns into this. There's some areas of green that need a little desaturation. The deeper areas where we would see more of the branches, more of the brown, more of the brush. And I'm going to even let those go slightly purplish to keep a nice color harmony into this image. So that's what I'm doing now to get a little variety in my shadows. It's really happening in the scene. We have reddish branches deep in that foliage, deep underneath the foliage. We have cool skylight and green leaves, and it'll actually give us kind of a brown purple down in there. And so we get richer shadow colors with green, warm browns, and they combine cool greens and they combine to make kind of a neutral purple. Yeah, and Robbie's asking about the greens, the green foliage, controlling the saturation on the trees, because it is very easy to get too saturated. Nature is mostly neutral, and almost everything in nature has some neutral. You know, it's not like 100% saturated. It's only kind of like the sky can be, the blue of the sky. Rare minerals, flowers are hypersaturated. When leaves are backlit by sun, you can get a vivid yellow green that'll be as saturated as colors can go. But other than that, leaves are rarely as highly saturated as your digital tools can go. So you want a little bit of restraint. You want to put a high saturation only if there's a good reason to do it. If you have a real good reason, otherwise keep them kind of a halfway in between gray and fully saturated and then choose from there. And for instance, look how saturated my copper tower is by intent. I don't want my foliage to compete with that. So I'm just kind of glazing now. I'm just glazing a little bit of color using a soft pen pressure texture brush. Where do I need to go a little lighter? Where I need to go a little darker? Where do I need to go a little warmer, a little cooler? I'm just kind of glazing some textures over top. Especially, I keep saying that the foliage has form. And there is foliage and leaves that are catching the skylight, that are sitting at the top. So that's what I'm sketching in now. Very softly, if I start getting too contrasty, I'm in trouble. But see how, for instance, what's lower screen left right now? Well, I just flipped back. Let's flip back here. Right here in lower screen right, notice how that actually feels like light hitting top planes. It looks like kind of fronds or branches down in there. I didn't have to do anything. I didn't even have to think about painting fronds or branches. I just had to think about what light really does. There's a thing, and then there's a dark under the thing, and then there's cool light hitting the thing. And I did that, and automatically, there's a suggestion of form happening in there. At the top of our middle tree right here, I have a little bit of that lighter, cooler value that suggests a top plane. It needs to be cooler. There's no direct red sunlight hitting this. It's only blue sky coming down from above. Same thing happening over here with this tree. And so I have that grouped as well. And then we get those richer, warmer colors, but with lower contrast down at the bottom to get our main event. And so with that, we have our final image. Folks, we are done with the demo here. And so I hope you like how it turned out. I hope that was helpful for you. I'm kind of happy with it, if you don't mind me saying. I certainly won't say that everything about this is perfect, but we had a goal. We had something we wanted to make this image about, a particular visual interest, a particular beauty, a particular striking quality of this particular location. And I think at least we got that to come through. And we were able to describe a little bit of perspective, a little bit of a form along the way. Okay, so that's the demo. So we've got some time. And if you guys have any further questions, and I see a few questions coming in to the chat. So I'll just check over and see what we can do for you. Okay. How do you decide where to keep the sharp, detailed forms in the foliage? And where to have the softer, blurrier stuff. So great question. There's two considerations with that. One is a real world consideration and one is an artistic consideration. So we at least need people to look at that and say, okay, yeah, those are trees or those are foliage. And so they need a suggestion of form and texture. And so you need to get enough information to tell the structure of what these things are. And to take advantage of that. So that's where my decision was, to have a little bit more visual information. The next decision is, though, artistically, where is it important to put information and where is it important not to draw the eye to too much? And as you saw, that was an important consideration. So in the reference, you know, there was a lot of stuff down in lower areas, not as much as at the top. And so more light hitting these top and more information up there is a real world thing, and a more shadowy bottom is a real world thing. But I exaggerated how simple and soft the bottom foliage was because I didn't want this painting to become about the lower half of the image. Good question. Okay. Let's see. Reading through your questions. You know, Sam's asking about using reference and really doing, making something out of the reference. And I want to point you to, I don't mean for this to be a plug, Sam, but I have a demo at the Lightbox website. We have a virtual exhibition hall there. It's amazing. It's like a new technology. And everyone, all the participating artists, literally have a booth you can go to and browse in this virtual hall if you've been there yet. And at my booth, I just have a button there. You click free demo. And that's what that demo is all about. I have some different references and I've pieced the references together to try and get a meaningful painting out of it. I want to point you to that and hope you find it helpful. Okay. And so let's jump to another question. Okay, so sorry about the pronunciation of your name, Nalayan, and you're laughing out loud how I just pronounced your name, but it's the best I've got. So yeah, the question was the challenge of painting daytime scenes versus nighttime scenes. And that's an interesting one, because in animated movies, we do nighttime scenes all the time. Well, in real life, night's very dark. Even under a full moon, you know, your eyes can adjust and see quite a bit at night. But in an animated movie, often you've got to bring it way up so that we can see everything we need to see when it's appropriate. And there's even a term for that. They call it day for night, meaning you're painting things so you can see them as well as you could see them during the day. But everything, for instance, has a blue cast to it. There's stars in the sky. And shadows tend to have less information in them, because under moonlight, you just can't see as much information in shadows. There's just not enough light in there. You see more information in the light. And so that's a definitive quality of nighttime. More information in the light, less in the shadow, and the lighting tends to be neutral. Even it can feel cool. There's a big debate, does moonlight have a color? Well, it's the yellowish light of the sun, but it's hitting the moon, which is very gray, and then bouncing back down. And it's so dim, the color receptors of your eyes have a hard time getting a color out of it. And so it's more kind of your value receptors in your eyes. So some people paint moonlight very green and get a remarkable effect out of it. It's more common to paint it blue, which simply makes it feel different than daytime. Some just paint it very neutral, but you get to decide. You can guarantee that nighttime will feel like nighttime. In fact, try this exercise. Paint a daytime scene, but make all of the light cool and put stars in the sky and have less information in the shadows and more information in the light, guess what? Everyone will assume, hey, it's nighttime, but you're doing this magical, luminous kind of a thing. We do that all the time in animation. If you look at a movie like Princess and the Frog, they had some scenes in that movie that they really lifted up into that kind of a palette. And so I would also suggest looking at references, how different artists have taken on that challenge. In the end, it depends what mood you want. Do you want something dark and frightening? Well, you kind of do what moonlight and nighttime really feels like. Do you want something else like what I just described? Go for that. So that's the final. It's interesting. As hardcore as I personally am about the technical skills and the draftsmanship, in the end, the thing that matters is the emotional connection. Those things aren't ends in and of themselves. They're only meant to serve the purpose of creating the emotional connection with your audience, to tell your story or to give the purpose of your artwork or your illustration. Okay, so let's take a look. Okay, and Eric's asking what the job title and track for this kind of artist in the industry. Yeah, because it's ever-changing. And different, you know, video games use a little bit terminology for what they do than animation, but there's a big crossover. I've had a chance to cross over and do a little bit with video games and vice versa with other artists. But typically, you know, if you are handed a story outline or an idea outline, and then you're asked, okay, visualize it for me. Do some sketches and paintings that show me what it looks like. And so you do a painting. Okay, let's see the script or the little treatment, they call it. And in animation, there's usually no script. There's something like a 10-page treatment. They slap that on your desk and they say, you know, okay, sketch boy, come up with something. It better be good. So you're like, gee, you start sweating and you try and come up with something. And so you look through, you identify what are the locations, who are the characters, and what are the particular moods at any given moment? And then you do paintings and sketches that try and show that. That's visual development art. In games, they commonly call it concept art. Same thing, visual development art, concept art. And in video games, it typically is more generalist, especially at smaller studios. And if you want to be a generalist, you want to do character design, environments, and you want to do kind of just overall viz dev illustrations and have your hands in the pipeline of creating the thing, small game studios tend to do that. Big studios have to put you in a box. It's good in some ways and sad in other ways, but I mean, it's an organization. The only way they can keep 500 artists and technicians organized is to say, okay, you're a character designer, you're a viz dev artist, and you are a modeler, and you are a, and they put you in that box. So I would be a VizDev artist, and I would go through that process that I just described. Slap the treatment on your desk, and I start painting and sketching look ideas. Character designer identifies who the character are, with their nature, and they start sketching out character designs. We usually have a 3D modeler, like we call it a pod. So you have maybe two concept artists, two character or VizDev artists, two character designers, and one concept modeler. And you get together and you figure out what this movie looks like. And then you each do your skill, and then you present it to the studio. Here's what we think the movie will look like. And that tends to be the track of how these things get broken down. So Eric, I hope that that's helpful for you. Okay, and Alice is asking a follow-up question to that. Appreciate that, Alice. Does the visual development and concept art team only work on the initial part of the animation project, or is there work to do after pre-production? And the answer to that is both. Some artists stay on for the entire show. So sometimes, I don't know, you might have some hotshot visual development artist that has a very distinctive style, and you might bring them in for 3 months, a year, and have them kind of do their pass, and then they move on in the pipeline. And then those things have to be interpreted into 3D and into the pipeline. And sometimes it's a really painful process. Sometimes the studio intentionally doesn't keep that person on because the style has to change. It has to be adapted to the 3D, you know, movie world. And the hardcore designer kind of gets brokenhearted over their beautiful designs being ruined and watered down by the process. Very painful. I always say, and it's kind of true, the process is a bloodbath and people coming on, and you have amazing artists who come onto a show and they'll do amazing work. They're great. But the director may well say to them, and the studio may say to them, "We love what you're doing. It's beautiful work. We feel like the show is going in a different direction. Thank you for your contribution." You know, and it depends on the terms of their contract, but they may be work for hire on a week to week basis. And so the studio will say, "Thank you so much. You know, we'd like to keep you on for a couple more weeks to wrap up what you're doing," and you're done. And people come on and off of these shows all the time. Directors come on and off of these shows. For me, it's been typical. The shows typically take 5 years of development, a brand new idea, and typically a movie goes through two or three sets of directors. The first set or two get fired off of the show or let go because the show takes on a new life, goes on a new direction. It is a painful, painful process. You've got to have a thick skin. And I'm going off on a little bit of a tangent to your question, I know, but I think this is helpful for those of you kind of coming up early on into the industry. It's an extremely painful process. But you have to have a thick skin in this business. The problem is not a single one of us go into art because we have a thick skin. Most of us don't. You know, we want to do something that we really hope our audience likes. We do it, we put it out there, we really, really hope our audience likes it. And if it gets shot down, it is so painful. But I don't know, visual development, it's common, 50, 60, 70, maybe even 90% of what you do doesn't end up getting used. You kind of throw a cluster of ideas out there, and it's a funnel. You gradually, you know, the director, "No, not that, no, not that. There's something to that. Hey, I like that. There's one, I like your lighting there, but not your environment. Let's keep that quality of lighting." You gradually funnel it down until you finally have a look. And then the people who just don't do that look move on. The people who do probably stay on. And some artists will stay on for the entire project for several years. And I've been on projects where I got to be part of visual development and then final location design. And then at that point, we have the 3D animatic shots and we have the final 3D models. And what we're able to do on the inside of the production pipeline is take the models and the animatics and use those as layouts and then paint lighting keys over top. So it'll be a rough model or a gray model and we'll paint over top of it as if it's a finished scene to show the finished look, the finished color, the finished lighting. That's my favorite part, frankly. I know all of you want to be hotshot front end artists to come up with the big concept. That's great. That process is so painful. I love that final look where you get to design the color and the light, but what's in the scene has been decided on at that point. So I hope that's an helpful, it's a long, but I hope helpful answer to your question about how the production pipeline works and who stays on and who doesn't. Okay, it's 3:30. I know you guys probably have stuff to get off to. There's so much over at Lightbox. I'll go ahead if any of you guys want to hold on. I see we still have quite a few people online. No worries if you check out. My feelings won't be hurt. But I'll go ahead and answer a couple more questions for any of you who want to keep on. But let me point out as you're headed out, I'd love for you guys to join me again tomorrow. We're doing portfolio reviews tomorrow, 2 to 4 o'clock Pacific time. Submissions are closed. We've already picked, and hang on, because I wanted that screen to be up for you so you can see it. There it is. We've already picked the portfolios that we're gonna go through for that. But I really encourage you to join us, all of you out there, because we're going to talk about the portfolios to answer the same question we're answering here. When there's a problem in your portfolio that we're going to be looking at, we're going to figure out, you didn't get to the heart of the image. What was the problem? Let's find a solution. And so I think we're going to have some good ideas come out of it on problem solving for any image you might come across. So I'm looking forward to seeing you guys for that tomorrow. Let's wrap up with a couple of questions if you'd like. So, and someone's asking, will the video be posted after? Yes, I'm not sure when, but we'll get this video up on my YouTube channel. It might be tonight. It might even have to be later in the week. Okay, so Alex is asking a great question about putting together your VizDev portfolio. Well, you have your specialty, you have what you love to do, and so you're going to want to emphasize what's best about what you do. But my simple recommendation is, you know, a lot of us have the art of books on our shelves, art of Pixar, art of DreamWorks, art of Blue Sky, art of the World of Warcraft, whatever it is. And those show you exactly what those artists do and need to do to create that project. And so that shows you, you know, what kind of art do I need to show? Hey, my dream is to work at Pixar. Get a couple of those books. They show you the entire pipeline of how they design it, how they draw for it, how they paint for it. And that's the perfect part of the portfolio. Okay. And Vitru, sorry, I can't pronounce your name, but how do you avoid making color muddy, especially a dark cinematic scene? I have a trick for that. So it's a formula, so don't use it all the time, but anytime you have a color and it's just muddy, but it needs to be there, you want it to be more rich, break it into three colors. Let's say you have a cool gray, but it's kind of dead. Purple cool gray green, and maybe a little bit of a neutral brown. Just, and keep them about the same value. Very subtle, they're very similar to each other. All of a sudden that gray, just put different patches, different variations of that. And you can even see that I do that a little bit in these kinds of paintings. The image that I have up here, it's really knocked down so that you can see the lettering over it. But you can see that I do that kind of thing in these images, the little variations of warm and cool in there. So that's a useful way to keep unmuted palate to keep some life in it if needed. Okay, and I'm looking over at your questions. I'm kind of peering past my eye patch here. Yeah, thank you for asking. Someone was asking about the workout sessions. I have a color and light workout at Schoolism, a practice demo you can do with me every day where you download references, and then I have a demo recorded for you. And we're really proud of these new workout series. So I have one on color and light and a new one similar to what we've done today coming out in October that's part of the Schoolism subscription. Any subscription, you get access to it. Okay, we're going to finish with this question because it's a great question. Khalid asks, is it better to be specialized or maybe a generalist? So only you can answer that question, of course, but here's what to consider. So there's someone who does highly stylized work. They have a very unique, very specialized style, and that's really amazing. And so from time to time, there's going to be projects where they're the hero. Hey, let's do a show that utilizes this artist's style. It's amazing. But then there's going to be a period where no one needs or wants that style. Yikes, what are you going to do? I don't know. You'll have to be working on your book, working on a different project, teaching your class or something, because people don't always need that style. If you're more of a generalist where anything they throw at you, hey, you can come up with a good, solid, competent image. Maybe it doesn't have a unique style or look, but you're a generalist and you can make an image. That's the other side. So you got to decide what range you want to be. This has limitations. You'll never be looked at as the hero of the art department, but you'll always be valuable. This person, amazing hero, but they will also have fallow times when there's just not a project for them. So decide. I think most of us probably somewhere in the middle. I kind of think of myself as being a little bit in the middle. I work on more painterly projects. I don't work on more graphic or cartoony projects because that's not my thing. But ultimately, you know, each of us, we have what we love and what we care about the most. And that thing is going to be what we're best at, because doing this is extremely hard. It takes a lot of heavy lifting, and only the people who are willing to do the heavy lifting on a daily basis will rise up above the crowd and get the opportunities that are there in this particular business. And even especially right now, animation and video games and concept art is doing pretty well. It's holding up through the good times and through the bad because people value what we do. They appreciate being taken to a place that they can only get to through us. What we just did, nothing like that exists exactly in that way in the real world, even though it's based on the real world. This scene that's up right now on screen, this fantasy castle, the only way that our audience can get that is by coming to us. And that's an excellent position to be in as an artist. It's a daily fight, but if you fight the fight daily, you're going to get there. So it's been great to be with you. I'll see you guys again tomorrow at 2:00. Thanks for being with me.